To me, this program is not a journalistic enterprise. It is about learning. Learning from people who have reached the top of their fields about their vision, experience, aspirations, and passions. In all my fields of endeavor, be it business, public service, policy research, or the media, I ask myself three questions. Am I helping to make a difference? Am I doing the best I can? And am I enjoying myself? Take a seat, make yourself comfortable, and let's go. Mr. Akashi, welcome.
Thank you.
Your career has spanned most of the 20th century when it comes to starting with the Second World War. You saw the Cold War, then the end of the Cold War, and now we are going through a different set of turmoils. So I'd like to talk about that whole journey as an international diplomat and Japan's most respected international diplomat as well.
Nice to be talking with you, Milinda.
Thank you.
My very, very dear friend. And although I think that you have an impossible task to talk with me on these long years, but I know.
I wouldn't consider it impossible at all. It's a pleasure. I thought if you could, we'll start with what made you go into diplomacy? What was the, how did you get involved in diplomacy?
It was not something which was carefully prepared and planned. On the contrary, I sort of stumbled into it, I think. First of all, the end of the Second World War came in 1945. I was then 15 years old. My generation of the young Japanese were totally confused and bewildered by Japan's surrender to the Allied powers, more particularly to the United States. And we were shaken by such an event, and that could not have happened, you know, if you believe that Japan was invincible. And my generation of Japanese had been trained to believe in the mythology of invincibility of Japan. So we were shaken to the ground, and it came in all kinds of ideas, thoughts, and ideologies, for instance, Marxists who had been in prison have been liberated, and they started to teach us about the glories of communism. And others started to tell us about how wonderful liberalism and democracy is. And so there was a total period of utter confusion. And fortunate for Americans, they knew both the merits and demerits of democracy. And some of them, of course, told us that democracy can solve anything. But the reality, as you know, is not. And totally sort of confused by all kinds of ideas and ideologies, I decided to study American political institutions, and I wrote my bachelor's thesis at the University of Tokyo about Thomas Jefferson and his political philosophy. And later, I had the opportunity of studying in the United States.
At the Fletcher School, I think, is it?
The Fletcher School, yeah. But before going to the Fletcher, I went to the University of Virginia, which was founded by Thomas Jefferson himself. Right. Jefferson himself was an enigma. On the one hand, he preached the Declaration of Independence and all the glories of American democracy, but he was a slave owner he had about 20 slaves. So, you know, democracy itself has a lot of mythology about it. But I was very much struck by three American politicians, Franklin, James Madison, and Alexander Hamilton. Mm-hmm. These people, you know, firmly believed in the mechanism of preventing dictatorships from emerging. They knew that when you give too much power, that power corrupts. And so, in the case of America, you have Congress, which is elected by people at large. You have president, who is the head of the executive branch. You have the third branch, which is the Supreme Court. And they checkmate each other. And thus prevents dictatorship from emerging. There is a lot of wisdom in it. As Winston Churchill said, democracy is the worst form of government except all others. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of truth in this rather ironical.
Then how did you get involved in diplomacy itself after you came back from the United States? What did you do?
Yeah. In fact, while in the United States, I went from the University of Virginia to the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy, right, which is a tiny graduate school.
Tufts University.
Yeah, for right, diplomats. And in between, I attended an international summer camp, mm-hmm, where I was suddenly called upon to make a speech about political situation in East Asia, which I did without much preparation. But in the audience, there was a British diplomat and a scholar who was a director at the UN Secretariat. For some reason, he was impressed with what I had to say. And he asked me, Japan's admission to the UN is imminent, and then they'll be looking for a political affairs officer, mm-hmm, from Japan. Would I like to apply for it? I had no idea of what he meant. I just wanted to become a scholar, researcher about international politics, so that Japan will not repeat her mistakes of the past.
This was in the 1950s, roughly when was this happening?
1955. 55, 56.
Okay.
And when I went to the Fletcher School, there was a professor of mine from MIT who somehow recommended me as a good student. And there were other applications, but for some reason, which I don't understand, I was chosen. And I still do not understand why I was chosen, but I was receptive of all kinds of ideas, theories, and I wanted to have an open mind in order not to make the same mistake as some Japanese political and diplomatic leaders did during the Second World War. And so, soon afterwards, I accepted this job at the UN. And
so you would have been in your late 20s then, or?
I was 26 years old. I was a very eager beaver for, you know, any good analysis of international and diplomatic theories. There was power politics, which was at vogue. Hans Morgenthau's theory was very rampant in those days. And so I was very receptive to all kinds of things. And I was permitted to take some graduate courses at Columbia University. And I was very eager to learn what goes on at the UN. And, you know, there are always simplistic theories to explain clearly what's behind complicated diplomacy in the world. But I came to find that, yes, there's a lot of truth that what is at work is power, power hungriness, and a lot of self-interest, or what they call national interest. But behind all these, there's also a degree of idealism and moralism represented by some of the leaders at the UN, like Dag Hammarskjöld, Second Secretary General of the UN, like Lester Pearson, who was the Canadian Foreign Minister during the Suez Canal Crisis of 1956. And Hammarskjöld and Pearson together devised UN Emergency Force, even though UN Charter mentions no, you know, UN Emergency Force.
They were able to interpret
it. It was a product of pragmatic needs.
Yeah.
And so these two thoughtful, imaginative people, they felt that it had to be created through a General Assembly resolution, which they did. And so there is a large degree of real political maneuvers and egoism, but there's a smaller but nevertheless existing idealism which tries to make this world a better place to live.
If you look at Japan's contribution, not in the financial sense, but to this ideal which you were referring to, the international ideal, the post, let's say, Second World War ideal, what would Japan's contribution have been? Is there a special contribution Japan has made to international sort of vision?
I think so. I like to think so. Hard-headed grown-ups, tend to, sniff at good ideas, but they tend to be very cynical about all these events. But what you need is a small, determined minority of people. Japan was admitted to the UN in December 1956, and soon afterwards, Japan started its activities. As you know, during the League of Nations days, Japan was one of the major powers, but Japan did not do much except to invade into China or to make Korea a colony of Japan. And of course, Japan paid reparations to make up for the damages to the neighboring countries. But there were those Japanese who thought Japan should do something more permanent. Within the limitations of the Japan's new constitution, we felt very strongly that Japan should respond to the invitation by people like Hammarskjöld and Lester Pearson. And we advocated Japan taking a more active part in all kinds of UN peacekeeping in the world. And it was rather ironic that later, in the 90s, after the end of the Cold War, there were new horizons which were open to countries like Japan, Germany, Canada, a few others. And we felt that with a small mobile force which intervenes between conflicting parties, you can do a lot to save the world from becoming a great danger to humanity as a whole.
If you were to assess that concept, a small mobile force that can intervene in a very strategic way, how successful has it been now when you look at it today?
Good question. We were not as successful as some of us might claim, but we were not totally unsuccessful either. What the UN does and does not do is usually beyond what UN can do anything about. I think UN is not as strong as a world government or a world federation, but at the same time, it's beyond, it's more than a collection of sovereign governments. It's somewhere in between. So these small, mobile, unarmed or lightly armed police forces have been sent to the Middle East, to Africa, and to some parts of Asia with considerable diplomatic positive results. And so there's a hardcore of supporters of such light UN presence, which is still present between India and Pakistan, yeah, in Kashmir, in the Middle East, between Arabs and Israel, and in about 8 or 9 African countries, half of which are rather heavily armed military presence between different ethnic communities, so that they will not come in conflict with each other.
You were, I know you were quite involved with peacekeeping in the UN, and do you feel that what are the lessons to be learned from that model? If you were assessing it today, what are the lessons there are to be learned?
I think there are positive lessons. There are also negative lessons. UN was very successful in Cambodia, in which after the 20 years of incessant conflict, we were able to separate forces, and three of the four major parties joined UN to safeguard free and fair elections under UN supervision, despite all kinds of challenges by so-called Khmer Rouge. We were able to carry out elections, and the end result was a democratic government with 90% of participation by electors, qualified electors in Cambodia. Similar success was registered in Mozambique, Namibia, and many other places. But not so fortunate were other stories in Somalia. UN was totally outnumbered by the faction of IDIT, and finally had to withdraw after particularly significant casualties were experienced by us to the American Marines and Pakistani forces. And so we had to withdraw from Somalia. In Rwanda, many Tutsis minority people were killed, assassinated by Hutus, yes, who are in the majority. UN had about 200 to 300 peacekeepers only. We were totally outnumbered, and we were witness, unfortunately, to the 500,000 deaths experienced by the minority people.
Now today, probably the UN faces the biggest challenge since it's maybe since it was founded, because there is a almost a school of thinking among powerful countries, especially the United States, sometimes questions its relevance. And in your view, what is the future of the UN? Does it need reform? And if so, what kind of reform does it need?
I think, Milinda, that we should not think of easy solutions. If we try to impose artificial so-called solutions to the UN in order to strengthen it, I think we will find ourselves in great trouble. The international community is not a real community yet. But of course, national border lines are becoming lower, and more people in the world come to think alike. And this is a big hope for all of us. But we are still far from it. And we have to build up from small results to more significant, larger results. Let's not be perfectionists, but we should go beyond modest results we have achieved so far. Lots of things are yet to be done, but like-minded people in the world should try to work together.
So even in the current situation where internationalism is looked down upon in many countries, I think, because there is a resurgence of nationalism, you still think there is hope? That's your message?
I think so. Let's not just dream of, better days to come. I think we have to work hard so that we can build up on positive results. Let's start from small, modest successes. And, let's learn lessons from our mistakes. And I think we should try to work together with other people from other countries, from other cultures. And I think there's no reason for us to despair of, what we might be able to achieve.
Does Japan have a special role in this transformation?
I think so. So does many other countries in the world, Sri Lanka and others as well.
We are coming to the end of the program. We haven't spoken at all about Sri Lanka, which has been very much part of your interest. You have had an association with Sri Lanka for over 15 years, starting with the peace process in 2001. What is the message you have for Sri Lankans in the context of the new world as it is emerging? What is the message you would have?
Sri Lanka is a small but a beautiful island country, very well located, and many people are anxious to visit Sri Lanka, but it's a nation with quite a number of ethnic and religious communities, and it's not a homogeneous country, but you have a number of ethnic communities, cultural communities, who are learning constantly to live together. And and you have been achieving successes, but there have been disappointments. But I'd like to tell Sri Lankan people that they have so much which they have already attained, and they should continue to build up small relationships so that they will become larger and more durable. I know a lot of good people in Sri Lanka working very, very hard, and they can also, you know, inspire others to do likewise. So let's not despair of what we cannot do today, but let's continue to build from small interpersonal relationships to something larger.
Thank you, Ambassador Akashi, on that very encouraging and not idealistic piece of advice. Thank you very much for joining us on the
program. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you.